Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander viewers are advised that the following program contains images and voices of people who have died.
My name's Kerry Reed-Gilbert, I'm a Wiradjuri, so I belong to the largest mob in New South. I'm the daughter of Kevin Gilbert, and I also follow in the footsteps of my father. I'm a Aboriginal poet, writer, artist, and activist. One of the things that people do know that, you know, my father, he was actually born on the riverbank in Condo, so the Lachlan River, otherwise known as Kalawa River. So, you know, He was the baby of eight, so he's a youngster of eight. He started actually his fight for human and equal rights for Aboriginal people when he was in jail by his poetry. So he actually started his writing in jail with the cherry pickers. That thing of, you know, Aboriginal people weren't paid equal wages, you know, even in the paddocks, you know, we were getting paid, 10 cents less or, you know, they're non-Aboriginal people. So again, one of the things is that he actually used his works, his writing and his words to try to get that human and equal rights, to try to let the wider Australian community, you know, that, you know, people were living in refugee camps here in this country, that Aboriginal people were in ghettos. When he was 23, that's when he went to jail. So he went to jail very young. And achieved so much when he was in jail, but also he died before his time because he actually died in 1993, which was, again, as you know, the year of the world's Indigenous peoples. So the reason my father went to jail, because he actually murdered my mother, me and Kevin's mother, and I was actually 3 months old when that happened, and my brother was nearly two. And he actually got life in the first instance because, again, he committed murder. But that was actually then, you know, like cut short to be around the 14 and a half years. So that was part and parcel of it, you know. Again, one of the things is that he actually did the ultimate sin, you know, in those days, because he actually killed a white girl and my mother was a white Australian. You know, my father actually had to go to jail to become the man that he became, but my mother had to die for him to become that man. But one of the things that happened with me and Kevin is that we actually went to live with Mummy. And Mummy is actually my father's sister, Joyce. And so Mummy was actually married to Daddy, and that's Ned. And Daddy was, he was actually a good man, you know. I always say he's a wonderful dad, but, you know, apart from the other stuff, you know, I guess he was, you know, he was a returned serviceman who came back with the things that returned servicemen come back. But Mummy and Daddy already had their own three kids, you know. And then from that, they ended up getting my brother Darryl, who was my auntie's boy. And then they ended up getting my brother and sister Linny and Paddy, or Paddy and Linny, who was Uncle Athol's too. And Uncle Athol had passed away, you know, when they were babies. And then when my mother passed away and my father went to jail, then Mummy and Daddy actually got me and Kevin. So we're actually very lucky that we actually weren't stolen, but we actually grew up, us four younger ones actually grew up underneath the welfare system. So we're actually state ward kids, so us four younger ones. So we grew up under that system, so which is always impacts you to the day you die, I think. You know, you never walk away from being a welfare kid or a state ward kid. But again, just in those days for what Mummy and Daddy, again, my father's sister, Joyce, what they achieved by having all us kids in those days, you know, was pretty amazing. So that's how come I end up being the youngest of eight. So, you know, there was Johnny, and then Meryl and Maureen, and then my brother Darryl, and then Paddy, and then Linny, and then Kevin and me. So that made me the baby, you know, so I'm the And I am the baby, and I was the baby, I've got to tell you that. And then when my father got out of jail again, he married Cora, and Cora had Kate and Ruth. And so that's then another trude for Kevin Gilbert. And then eventually then he got married to Ellie, and Ellie had Oka and Kalara. So that then made me the second eldest of the six. So that's how I, you know, that's how I actually came into being a part of this great big mob that, you know, that's my family. Every time Mummy was, well, we were heading over to visit him, you know, he'd get his hair done and cut and, you know, all spruced up and, you know, the white shirt on and all that kind of stuff, you know, because his big sister was visiting. So again, that humanness of him, you know, as a little brother still, you know, even when he was, you know, 50 or 40 or whatever, you know, his big sister was coming, you know, and that was very, very important for him. You know, family was always important for him. And, you know, and showing that love, I guess, was really, really a part and parcel of who Kevin Gilbert was. And I'm going to show you a painting that he actually painted for Mummy, and that he painted this painting about pregnancy, you know, pregnant woman, because he's seen Mummy, who's his sister Joyce, as being the essence of womanhood, because she reared up him, you know, she reared up his not only him, but also his younger sisters. His artworks and through his poetry and all that kind of stuff. He not only fought for human and equal rights for Aboriginal people, but he fought as an Aboriginal man for the keeping together of the kinship family, of the family itself. So I think that's pretty well amazing. Again, like I said, he really achieved against all odds in so many different ways. And, you know, that he was a part of the 10 Embassy, so he's a part of that. He was a part of the Treaty 8 campaign. So again, my father wrote the first draft treaty. So, you know, really looking at Aboriginal sovereignty and justice and land rights for us as a people. You know, one of the things that people forget, and it's really great that, you know, 40 years later that, you know, my father's now got the recognition of the 10 Embassy, you know, for a long time he was forgotten, you know, as a 10 Embassy person. And so it's taken me a long time to fight for that recognition, you know, to get him that recognition as well. And I don't know what happens to people sometimes that, you know, history sort of gets lost somewhere along the line. But also too, you know, one of the things with my father is he's a Treaty 88 man. You know, his soul was for a treaty. And I remember when we were doing the protest up here at New Parliament House, you know, the push for the Treaty 88, you know, the badges, making the badges, doing all that, you know, the flyers and, you know, the pamphlets and all that to get that Treaty 88 campaign going was really, really important. And again, one of the things is that, you know, again, he wrote the first draft treaty. And that was very, very important. But I'm also a treaty person as well. Like, I guess, you know, that's my passion as well. And why, I guess, for both of us, not that I can really talk for my father, but I think one of the reasons that the treaty is so important for both of us is that it's a way that we get human and equal rights in this country. We get recognition. But also the treaty gives us a bargaining power. And we haven't got anything in this country. And with him being a treaty man and with him writing the treaty, it gave us some kind of bargaining. And again, one of the things that I do is I use a lot of my works and my poetry and my artwork is to try to fight for that treaty. So this poem is, again, following my father's footsteps is really, really important, you know, and, you know, really keeping the struggle alive and that fight for human rights is the essence of who I am as well. And I guess everybody knows I'm a treaty person as well, so it's very important. But it's also very important to use all our words and to get the message out there so that people understand, you know, where we really are in this country, that we're still at the bottom of the food chain. So I think that's important for me to do. And I use my poetry the same as my father used his works to do the same as that. And this is called And the Sign Said. Today I rode the bus through Newtown in the lucky land of Oz. I saw two old men sitting down. They sat at a rickety old table on worn-out chairs. A sign flashed before my eyes, "Will you help our kids?" I looked and saw the face of an Aboriginal child. Tears sprang to my eyes as I watched the people pass them by. Not one coin did I see go into the collection box. With a broken heart, I heard me cry, "Hang your head in shame, Australia, for your hypocrisy and your lies." This painting was painted because of the play, The Cherry Pickers, and my father wrote the play in 1968 while he was in jail, so I'm not quite sure if people know that he was the first Aboriginal playwright, the first Aboriginal printmaker, but also the first Aboriginal person to ever write a political book called Because White Men Never Do It. And, you know, I'm very lucky to be able to say that, you know, these are my pride and joys of, you know, of his works, and I'm very honoured to be his daughter and, you know, to see the achievement of this amazing man. And again, as I said, this painting here is really important to me because this is who we are as a family. You know, I always say to people, I come from the paddocks, you know that song, Loretta Lynn's song, "I'm proud to be a coal miner's daughter"? Well, I'm proud to be a cherry picker's daughter because that's who I am. This isn't just one generation. This is generation after generation because my father was in the paddocks, I was in the paddocks, and so was my kids in the paddocks, you know. And so when you read the play, The Cherry Pickers, or when you see the play, The Cherry Pickers, you get an understanding of what it's like as an Aboriginal people out there in the paddocks, you know, working, you know, really for a boss. That really sees you as an income. And, you know, I can tell you the days where we actually, you know, I remember the days where we actually got 10 cents a pound and the non-Aboriginal people, the white people, got 20 cents. You know, getting up early in the morning, Mummy used to always say spowerfart, you know, getting up early in the morning, you know, there was always that laughter and that humour, you know, and that sense of family. So that's very, very important, and I guess that's why I love this painting so much. And I guess really for me, you know, is why my father wrote The Cherry Pickers, because he would have, you know, in between those four walls in that jail, he would have been trying to capture the essence of his family and reliving that, you know. So you have a real affinity with that, and especially as his daughter or any of his family members, you know, you can see him trying to capture the essence of us and relive it between those pages. So I think that's really important. I'm very honoured to say that hanging in the collection of IATSIS is my father's lino prints and my photography. So that's an honour. As a part of 2013, to celebrate the 20th anniversary of my father passing away this year, we've done many, many different things, and a major exhibition is I Do Have a Belief. That was held at the Belconnen Arts Centre, and it showcased his works.
He did write the first draft treaty, and if you can get a copy, that's great, because it does look at what it's all about for us as a people. But I just want to finish, you know, I get plenty of time to come down here and yarn up at the Tin Embassy, but I just want to read you one of his poems. I'm going to finish up on that because I think that's really, really important, because my father's heart was here at the Tin Embassy to the day he died.
And this is called Winter Camp, Aboriginal Tin Embassy. We see them, shoulders hunched, standing in the rain, eyeing distant mountains, glimpsing love and pain. Pictures of a loved one, children happy, strong, dancing in the sunlight, chanting the land rights song. We see them, faces gaunted, sitting in the frost, staring at the embers and a flame that's never lost. Beacon to burn for justice, human spirit flames for love, to light the page of history with their heroic form. Mm-hmm. So the Tin Embassy is very, very important to all of us, and it's something that we have to take the spirit of the Tin Embassy and keep it alive, you know, no matter who we are, where we come from in this country. And the Tin Embassy belongs to every Aboriginal person in this land. Mm-hmm.